Okay, I guess we're into the customer survey. This is quite exciting. I'm not sure we've ever done a customer survey of this extent in the past, so we're very much looking forward to it. And sorry, Vivek, you have to see it again, but that's...
Perfect. All right. Hi, everyone. I'm Catherine. I'm from Great Blue. I'm just going to share my screen real quick that has our presentation on it. It's expanded. Excellent. So to get started, so we did your customer satisfaction survey this year, and as a spoiler alert, very positive ratings throughout. So I think you'll find, a lot of very interesting insights in here. To touch really briefly, I kind of skipped through the Great Blue portion, but we do a lot of research with, we're a marketing research company, but we do a lot of research with utilities specifically, and specifically we do a lot of other research with the meme utilities, so basically all Massachusetts utilities. So we do have some kind of points in here where we benchmark your data against those Massachusetts kind of benchmarks. So briefly to touch on sort of what we were trying to get at in this project. So we surveyed both residential and commercial customers of RMLD here. We used a telephone and a digital survey methodology in an effort to reach as many customers as we could. And you'll find that we did end up reaching a lot of your customers. And the overall goals here were to identify, strengths and weaknesses of RMLD, identify any areas for improvement so that you might ultimately increase customer satisfaction ratings in the future.
If I may, by the way,
here are our areas.
Did you want us to keep our questions till the end, or did you want us to the commissioners to ask questions as we go through?
I think it's probably best if we keep them towards the end. I think for speed and everything, that'll probably be best. And then I can always flip back to any pages, as we go.
Okay, thank you.
Perfect. So yeah, of course. So here's the areas of investigation. And I kind of like to think of this like chapters in a book, essentially. This is really your table of contents of ultimately the topics that we're going to cover throughout the presentation. And without getting into too much depth here, we go through a lot of overall satisfaction criteria, customer service, communication tools, outage restoration, awareness of the customer notification system, importance of greenhouse gas reduction, awareness of time of use rates, energy efficiency and rebate programs, likelihood to purchase an electric vehicle, air source heat pumps, as well as interest in a self-service portal. So now looking at the research methodology snapshot. So basically what you're going to find throughout this presentation is we have both the residential and commercial. So you'll see first slide will be residential and then it'll be followed by the commercial slide as both surveys were very identical to one another. So as far as completes for the residential side, like I mentioned before, we did telephone and digital surveys. We ended up with 1,610 total completes, 400 by phone, and then 1,210 online. So we had a very high online response rate for this one. That ended up yielding a margin of error of 2.3%. So essentially what that means is if we conduct this study 100 times, 95 out of 100 times, that's that 95% confidence level here, the results will vary within 2.3 percentage points plus or minus the results that I present in this report. So that's considered a very good margin of error as far as marketing research goes. And then the research dates, we fielded this throughout all of December and a little bit into January. We always like to include this just because it's important to know that the data that we collect here is really a snapshot in time. And this is essentially how your customers felt during this period of time in which we ultimately fielded this survey. And then on the commercial side, we ended up with 110 completes here, 88 by phone, and then 22 online. And that yielded a margin of error of 9.2%. And again, the research dates were the same for the commercial survey. We fielded them simultaneously. Now looking at the respondent snapshot for our residential customers, so just some demographic criteria before we really get into the data. You'll find that most of these customers, 80%, came from single family homes, and the vast majority own versus rent their residence. And then we had a pretty even, relatively 50-50 split on gender as well. Now looking into some of the criteria, general makeup of your commercial customer base that we spoke to for the survey, the majority of these businesses were smaller businesses with less than 15 employees. As far as length of time as a customer, we're seeing a lot of folks fill into that category of 20 years or more, or 15 to less than 20 years. So a lot of customers that we spoke with have been your customer for a while. Type of business, seeing a good variety here, but a lot of office spaces, manufacturing, industrial, and retail spaces. More for the commercial respondent snapshot, when we asked folks if they had any electrically sensitive equipment, a lot of people didn't really know what that meant, but those that did said that they have refrigeration equipment, voltage sensitive equipment. Business ownership, we had slightly more folks saying that they rent their business versus own their residence. And then a pretty even split as far as square footage goes as well. Now to go right into the key study findings of the report. First, we asked a lot of these questions to, in our fairly standard utility surveys as far as characteristics of the organization, just so we can get kind of a good picture of how customers feel about the utility on an overall level. And so what you see here, these are kind of those common characteristics that we use. Ultimately, the RMLD average for all these characteristics was 92%. And what you'll see on all of these charts is that we essentially break the data out into composite, which is just the total. And then we have phone and online. And in here, we have that meme average that I talked about before. So this is what, of the Massachusetts utilities that we do work with, only the municipal ones, these are the average scores that of all those utilities from the past like 10 years, basically. This is the historical tracking average that we have. So you'll see that RMLD is right in line, slightly under the mean average, but very close to the mean average. Very high scores across the board, the highest ratings for reliable service and for honesty and integrity. We do see lower scores for helping customers use energy more efficiently. Historically speaking, and just kind of, national data that we collect from a lot of different utilities across the country, usually customers provide lower ratings for this area simply because they're not fully aware of what resources their utility actually provides to them and the ways that they can actually save energy. So it is the lowest rating, but it's 86.4%. So it's definitely nothing to be concerned about. And then on the commercial side, again, we rated them on the same characteristics. We're once again seeing the highest ratings for reliable service and honesty and integrity. And then again, lower ratings for helping customers use energy more efficiently. And that ultimately yields an average rating for commercial customers of 88.6%. So very high as well. Now looking at the customer service department. So again, in all of these kind of charts here, we're really going to focus on the green bar, which is your composite data, but then we just break it out into phone and online. And so on a composite level, residential satisfaction with customer service is very high at 92.5%. And the table on the right illustrates the top 10 reasons why folks were contacting customer service over the past year. We're seeing outages number one, followed by having a question on a bill, not any kind of a complaint. And then looking for more information about rebates is number three. And now customer service satisfaction among your commercial customers. Again, very high satisfaction here at 87.5% among those 40 respondents that actually had some kind of an interaction with RMLD. And of those respondents, we're seeing them primarily contact customer service regarding a question on their bill as well, or to install their service. And next, this slide kind of goes hand in hand with the last one. We look at first contact resolution, if things are generally resolved upon the first point of contact, or if folks really need multiple points of contact in order to have their issue resolved. What we see here on the residential side is that over 4/5, so 81.4%, said that their issues are usually taken care of to their satisfaction the first time rather than needing repeated contact. And this really does play a substantial factor in influencing the customer service scores that we just saw on the previous slide, because obviously people are more satisfied with customer service when their issue is just taken care of right off the bat rather than having to keep contacting them repeatedly. We're seeing a similar pattern on the commercial side. 87.5% said that Reading takes care of things the first time rather than needing multiple contacts. Next, we asked folks to best describe their relationship with RMLD. They're either less than satisfied, satisfied, a loyal customer, or an advocate of RMLD. And then we combine those that said they're an advocate, loyal, or satisfied customer into this net positive score in this kind of bubble chart on the right. Ultimately, that yields net positive score for you all of 96%, which is extremely high and very comparably high with the average meme net positive score. Again, this is among those Massachusetts utilities that we do work with. That score is 96.8%. So very high scores across the board. And again, for the commercial customers as well, we saw a net positive score, again, advocates loyal and satisfied, of 93.6% among those commercial customers. Now looking at the municipal ownership model, we ask customers next to identify which of the following best describes their utilities ownership model. And it's either a community owned municipal utility or an investor owned utility, or they don't know or they're unsure. And so, you know, of our residential customers, we see that over 4/5, 82.3% did correctly identify their utility as being community owned. And that is very high. You know, on a national level, we usually see this number coming at around 60%. So 82.3% is very positive. And then we see the vast majority of residential responses, 91.3%, did say that it's important that their utility is municipally owned. And on the commercial side, slightly lower awareness that RMLD is a community-owned utility, 69.1%, but again, it's still over 2/3, so still the majority of customers are aware, and 83.6% of those commercial customers did find that municipal ownership model to be important to them. Next, looking a little bit more at what it means to be a community-owned municipal utility, we ask customers to rate four different characteristics that are common of community-owned utilities on a scale of 1 to 10, one being that they strongly agree with, you know, that RMLD embodies that characteristic, and then 10 that they strongly disagree. And so essentially what you see here is those combination of those ratings of 1 to 4 for each of these. And what you'll see across the board is that residential customers, you know, the vast majority of them do believe that RMLD lives up to all of these characteristics of community-owned utilities, most notably that RMLD provides reliable service and responds quickly during an outage. And we're seeing similar things on the commercial side, slightly lower ratings, but once again, we're seeing more folks, you know, really agreeing that RMLD provides a reliable service and, you know, responds quickly whenever there is an outage. Now looking into communication preferences, no surprise here that, you know, in this little bubble in green, that the, you know, about 2/3 of customers would prefer to look for information about RMLD on the website. And on that note, when we ask customers to rate the value of a couple different RMLD communication preferences, the RMLD website did receive the highest ratings for value, followed closely by the email newsletters. And on the commercial side, we're also seeing 69.1% of folks would prefer to look for information on the website. And once again, the website did receive the highest ratings among commercial customers for the value that it provides them. Now looking at outage restoration times, we break these questions up into, you know, obviously we remove folks who haven't experienced an outage in the past 12 years just because they're not really able to answer the question. But of those that did experience an outage in the past, I believe I just said 12 years, 12 months in the past year, we asked them to rate, you know, if they experienced an outage that was not related to a major storm or one that was related to a major storm. And that's kind of broken up in these two charts. And so what you see here is that 84.7% of the time to restore power after a storm relate that was not related to a major storm was acceptable, versus 87.3% who said the time to restore power after a storm that was related to major storm was acceptable. And then once again, on the commercial side, we're also seeing very high ratings here for how acceptable the time to restore power was after both a minor storm and a major storm. So for a minor storm, seeing 89.5% said that that time to restore power was acceptable versus 83.3% that said the time to restore power after a major storm was acceptable. Next, looking at the customer notification system. First, specifically diving into RMLD's Twitter, just as far as notification systems go. We're only seeing 14.7% of residential customers currently receiving outage updates through RMLD's Twitter. And then nearly 2/5, so 39.6%, so they're aware that Reading is in the process of implementing a customer notification system. What we do see that about a little over a quarter, 26.8%, don't want to receive any additional information through the customer notification system. Those that do would prefer to see information about things like upcoming rate changes, as well as new program and service offerings. And on the commercial side, we're seeing fewer folks using RMLD's Twitter for outage updates, 8.2%. We're also seeing fewer folks, 22.7%, that are aware that RMLD is in the process of implementing that customer notification system. More commercial respondents, 51.8%, said that they do not want to receive information through the customer notification system, but those that do would like to receive information about upcoming rate changes as well as new program and service offerings. Next, we ask customers to rank the priority or the importance of three different characteristics pertaining to their electric service. And so those characteristics are reliability, cost, and the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions. And so what we see here is that on the residential side, over one half of customers in this green bar here, 54.6% said that reliability was the top priority, followed by 30.9% that says cost of electricity was their top priority. And that's followed by 14.6% that said the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions would be their top priority. Then on the commercial side, similarly, we're seeing a, you know, pretty much the same pattern here of, you know, reliability as the top priority among most customers, followed by cost. And then lastly, the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions. Now looking at greenhouse gas emissions in a little bit more depth, two-thirds of residential customers, so 67%, would like RMLD to be aggressive with respect to setting goals to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. And then when asked what percentage increase, if any, that they would be willing to pay on their electric bill to compensate for you know, RMLD expanding their green initiatives, obviously we see 31.4%, so close to a third, so that they're not willing to pay any more money. But of those that are willing to pay some amount more on their electric bill, we did say 21.7% so that they'd be willing to pay 5% more, and then 19.9% would be willing to pay 10% more.
Just a quick point of clarification there. Sorry.
Dave, I thought we were going to save our questions till the end, please.
Aren't there other tranches other than the 5% and 10%, whether you answer now or later? It's more than just those two numbers, isn't it?
Correct. Yeah. So basically, the way the question is set up is essentially.
Do it later. I don't mean to interrupt.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's do it later.
No. And honestly, I can explain it now. But essentially, you're asked, would you pay 25% more? And then if they say no to that, you're asked the next option of 20% more, and then 15% more. So essentially, it's kind of a trickle down of, would you pay this much, and then this, this, and then some people are just like, I don't want to pay anymore. So that, if that kind of clears anything up with the way the question's asked. And then you same on the commercial side here, you know, similar pattern of 32.7% are not willing to pay more, but 30% are willing to pay 5% more, and 20.9% would pay 10% more. So what we're seeing on both ends here is that, you know, a small segment of customers are willing to pay a small amount more per utility bill, but, you know, not many are willing to pay, you know, up to 15, 20 or 25% more essentially. And then
just
over
at the end, please just tell us what the cumulative, when you add those percentages up of people who are willing to pay.
Yeah.
Cumulative percentage. You can do it later or now, either way.
Right. Yeah. and then over three-fifths, so 61.8% of commercial customers would like RMLD to be aggressive with respect to setting goals to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. Now looking at time of use rates. On the residential side, over one half of customers, 53.5%, were aware that RMLD does currently offer a time of use rate structure. And a similar frequency, 54.8%, said that they would be interested in switching to that rate structure in the future. On the commercial side, awareness of the time of use rate structure offering at RMLD was a little bit lower at 40.9%. And so was interest in ultimately enrolling in this program. Only about 36.4% were interested in switching to the time of use rate. Now looking more at specific energy efficiency programs, starting with the residential side, we asked customers to rate, again, on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 to 4 being aware, how aware they were of different energy efficiency and rebate programs at RMLD. And so we see the highest level of awareness of the Energy Star appliance rebate, as well as the no-cost home energy assessment, and lower levels of awareness of other programs like the electrical panel upgrade rebate. And essentially what I've been informed is that some of these programs that you know, or towards the bottom here, i.e., a little bit lower awareness of these programs. These tend to be some of the newer programs that are being rolled out. So they simply need to gain traction over time as more, communication goes out about them. And then on the commercial side, these are the list of commercial, rebate offerings that we presented to those customers in the survey. And we saw the highest level of awareness of the renewable energy rebate, lighting retrofit program, and the energy assessment program. Looking more in depth at those energy efficiency rebate programs, on the residential side, we're seeing over two-fifths of customers, so 42.7%, have previously used one of Reading's residential energy efficiency rebate programs, but a much higher frequency of customers, 84.9%, so that they would be interested in using one of these programs in the future. And then of those, folks, the other segment of folks who haven't previously used one of those energy efficiency programs in the past, over a third, 35.1%, said that this is because they were simply unaware that that program was being offered to them. And on the commercial side, we're also, we're seeing a lower, usage of those commercial energy efficiency rebate programs at 14.5%. And once again, a lot of folks are citing that they're, were simply unaware of these program offerings, and that's why they hadn't previously used one. But once again, we are seeing high, a much higher rate of customers, 71.8% would be interested in using these programs in the future. So definitely on both sides, perhaps there's low utilization so far, but there's a lot of interest in these programs in the future. So definitely room for, further education about these programs and which program would kind of fit best for each customer. Looking into electric vehicles, specifically on the residential side, we asked customers how likely they would be to purchase an electric vehicle in the next 3 years. What you'll see over here is that 20.5%, so about a fifth of customers, are likely to purchase an electric vehicle in the next 3 years. And of those that aren't likely to purchase an electric vehicle, the top primary drawbacks that a lot of people are still seeing are that higher initial cost to purchase is continuing to be a major factor for a lot of people. Limited range and distance per charge, some uncertainty about, if I charge up my car, how long is that going to last me? How far can I go? And then again, the low availability of recharge stations, just as those are kind of building up across the country, a lot of people aren't really sure how many there are in their area, perhaps, and, don't want to really rely on them if there's not that many of them out there. And then for those customers who previously said that they would be likely to purchase an electric vehicle or that they already own one, we see that 74%, so almost three quarters of those folks would be likely to install an electric vehicle charger at their home to go along with that electric vehicle. Next, for our commercial customers, we asked how likely they would be to install an electric vehicle charger at their business. We saw only 14.5% were likely to install one at their business. And the primary reasons for that are that, many of them, their employees simply aren't driving electric vehicles at this time, so they don't have as much of a need for the charger station at their company. And then, like what I mentioned before, we do have a lot of the businesses that filled out the survey rent their space versus owning. And so about a third of the commercial customers said that they simply wouldn't, they don't have the ability to install a charger, and that's why they wouldn't install one. Now, looking at air source heat pumps, on the residential side, a little over a quarter were knowledgeable of the concept of air source heat pumps. So that's why when the follow-up question, how interested would you be in installing an air source heat pump? A lot of folks that they don't know are unsure, likely because they need more education about the topic to really understand what the, what this entails and what the benefits are and if they should do so. So that's why that number is a little bit higher. Similarly, on the commercial side, less than a quarter, 23.6%, said that they're knowledgeable of the concept of air source heat pumps. And that also attributes to the higher ratings for those folks who are not at all interested in those air source heat pumps, or that they're unsure if they would install one at their business. So next, we ask customers residential customers how likely they would be to install any equipment at their home that will significantly increase their electric usage. And so only 15.1% were likely to do so in the next 3 years, I believe it was. And then we see that, you know, when asked if they're going to add any of the following generation to their home in the next 3 years, over two-thirds, 69.7%, were unsure if they would be adding any of that generation, and 16.6% said that they would not be adding any generation. And then on the commercial side, we see 18.2%, so nearly a fifth, said that they will likely be adding equipment to their business that will significantly increase their electric usage in the coming years. And then when asked if they were planning to add any generation, we see 52.7% were not likely to add any generation. And then another 35.5% were unsure if they would be adding that generation. Now looking at the self-service portal among residential customers, over three quarters, 77% were interested in RMLD introducing a self-service portal. And they were read this little description on the left before they were asked to answer that question, just so that they have a little bit of a basis and background knowledge of it. Then obviously, you know, a lot of people wanted all of these features to be included in the self-service portal. We see very high ratings across the board here, but ultimately the top, you know, most prioritized features of the self-service portal among residential customers were the ability to apply for rebates, as well as the ability to view customer electric usage and consumption data. And then on the commercial side, we also see high interest here. Two-thirds of customers on the commercial side are interested in RMLD introducing the self-service portal. Once again, many commercial customers prioritize all of these features, but ultimately the top ones are bill payment and the ability to apply for rebates. And that covers all of the data. I'll touch briefly on some of the considerations that we came up with based on the data that that I just presented to you. So on the residential side, one of our considerations was to educate customers more about the time of use rate. So we did see that over half of customers were aware RMLD offers the time of use rate, but obviously with it being, I think, about 53% of customers who were aware, there's still a lot of room to grow and boost that number. Especially now during a time when a lot of folks are still working from home and, you know, able to probably take advantage of the time of use rate a little bit more, just knowing that their hours are a little bit different, they're at home all day, they can do things like run the dishwasher, run the laundry, you know, what have you, during hours when they previously couldn't. So it's something that folks can really take advantage of more during this time. Our second one was to promote energy efficiency and rebate programs. So like I mentioned a couple slides ago, there were some programs that, you know, whether they're kind of new programs or whatnot that folks were a little bit less aware of. And then the current usage of the programs was a little bit lower. And so, but the interest ultimately in participating in these programs was high. And so, you know, obviously there's some value to educating customers a little bit more about what these programs look like and which programs they may qualify for and, you know, ultimately help them the most. And on the commercial side, I also had a consideration about promoting those energy efficiency rebate programs, just because, again, there were some programs where awareness levels were a little bit lower for them. Ultimately, usage of these programs on the commercial side was lower than on the residential side. And so there's definitely room to boost participation in those programs. And also, you know, ultimately, we did see on that first slide that I went over that the lower ratings were for, you know, providing you know, ways for you to save, to use energy more efficiently. And so this is really an opportunity to kind of boost ratings in that area, you know, and educate folks that there are ways that they can save energy and conserve energy through RMLD. And then lastly, on the commercial side, I had improved awareness of RMLD's community ownership model. So again, like I mentioned previously, you know, awareness that RMLD is a community-owned utility was still high on the commercial side, but it was a little lower than on the residential side. So there's definitely room to grow that awareness and ultimately, you know, that knowledge of what it means to be a customer of a community-owned utility, just because there are so many benefits to it. But if you don't really know that your utility is community-owned, you might not really fully understand those benefits. So it's definitely a way to drive customer satisfaction moving forward. And then I'll just leave it here for a second. This is kind of our contact information. All of these people have touched the project in some way. So good ways to reach out if you have any questions after this presentation. This is our phone number at the bottom as well. We're from Glastonbury. And that's everything. So I can open up to questions if anyone has any. I can go back to that slide that we went over previously if you'd like.
I'd like to open it up for the commissioners to ask you some questions, some of which perhaps you can answer, perhaps some you cannot at this time. Did the COVID impact over this past year have any impact on the answers you think you received, especially from some of the energy saving programs, which we do push pretty hard, certainly on the residential side?
Yeah, so I think that across the board, I'd say that the COVID impact that we've seen has been more response rates of certain surveys. What we've seen on the residential side is a lot better response rates because they've been at home. So, you know, traditionally we only call on residential surveys our three to nine shifts. So in kind of like the evening hours, because more folks are at home. Now we're able to call on those projects all the time because a lot of people are working from home. But on the commercial side, it's been the opposite. It's been a lot harder to reach businesses. And that's why you'll notice, obviously we had fewer completes on the commercial side, mostly due to the fact that a lot of businesses sadly are out of business now, or they're working remotely and we don't have a way to reach them if they don't have their, you know, their main business phone that was perhaps their contact point. So essentially we've seen a lot more of it on the response rates. We have seen across the board some minor dips in satisfaction ratings, just kind of on a general level. As far as energy efficiency programs go, I personally haven't seen anything as far as, you know, really here what we measured was awareness of those programs. And I don't know that COVID would have had too much of an impact on that. I think maybe some folks were more likely to research those program offerings just because so many people were unfortunately out of jobs or, you know, in need of kind of finding new ways to save money. I could probably foresee people doing more research of those programs than they would have done before. But I haven't seen, you know, on a bigger level, a ton of COVID impact in that area.
Thank you. Other commissioners, would you care to ask any questions?
Yeah, just going back to that same one, I got that there's 58% of the respondents said they're willing to pay more for cleaner energy. Did I get that?
Yeah.
Up the different numbers, it's 58% said they're willing to pay more, but whether the amount magnitude is different, but can you go over that?
Yeah, I'll go back to that slide just so we can all kind of have the visual for it. It'll just take me a second because I have a presentation, but I do remember going through it and in my head getting around 60%. I think that you are accurate there.
Yeah, so 60% of people said they're willing to pay more, not just the 21 and the 19 that you mentioned earlier.
Right. Yeah. What I was more so spotlighting is the areas where, you know, I think it's important to know that more people are willing to pay either 5 or 10% more, just because that's a big difference than 20 or 25% more. So while it is 60%, it's, you know, it's smaller amounts per bill that folks are willing to pay, which I think is, that's why I kind of noted that.
All right. So 31% say, no, I don't want to pay any more, but almost 60% said they are willing to pay more. And it's just whether it's 5, 10, 15, 20, 25 adds up to
exactly.
Okay. And then there's 9% who didn't answer. So,
and that's a big number, disparity between the ones who want to pay a lot and ones who want to pay a little. But, you know, I think it sets up the tone for if people are willing to pay more, then perhaps we think in other sessions about how to implement something like that in terms of a fund, a specialized fund or whatever, to realize and let people pay whatever they would care to pay in additional, but we need to keep it somewhat separate from just the overall community. And I think we need to discuss that in our next meeting. I think it's a really good idea. And other variations on a theme from that, obviously.
John, can I make a comment?
Yes, please go ahead, Colleen.
Yeah, I just want to chime in then that we had asked at the CAB meeting that these numbers are cumulative. They're not per year. So it's not 10% or 5% every year, because we're going to have other rate increases due to CPI, union contracts.
Right.
And also, when we go over policy 30, we have the green choice, we got the community solar choice, and now we're going to have the renewable choice, which is specifically set up for people who want to pay more, then they can pay a premium. But Greg will get into that next, but it does dovetail into this customer survey. Thanks.
The other thing I found interesting was that 20% of people from your survey are likely to purchase an electric vehicle within 3 years. And I think that certainly got ramifications in terms of what the RMLD's load factors need to be able to service those. You know, if we believe that the data that they're anywhere close to that, you know, within 3 years, how do we work backwards to have, to be able to meet that need basically without blowing up transformers? Did I get that right?
You got the number right.
That's Mr. Chair?
Yes, please go ahead, Phil.
Yeah, a couple. I mean, first off, this is great, but please remember this is hypothetical. We'd be interested to see if there's actually a real number that's put out there, what this reaction would be. So I think we should maybe temper a little bit because this is a hypothetical number in terms of this. There's really no number behind it at this point. My question would be, did you identify in this survey anybody, landlords, any kind of reaction from them as to what they may, their feelings would be?
Yeah, so we didn't, there may have been possibly landlords in the commercial survey. We don't have any way of breaking them out. We didn't have a question about that or a tag. I don't believe in the sample file that would identify those, but there may have been some that were mixed in. And if they were, they would fall into that commercial category.
Okay. Yeah, because the other comment I make is, you know, I live in a condo and you know, a lot of condos in Reading. I live near the train station in Reading, and I can't understand why we don't have some sort of charging station by the train station, but that's my own personal crusade, I guess. So
it's a good one.
Yeah.
John, can I chime in?
Please go ahead.
Phil, you'll be happy to know that we've been working diligently with the town for this new electric vehicle level 3 and level 2 charging. And we're looking at 5 different locations in Reading, and down near the train station is one of them. But there's some pretty tough criteria to get the grant for accessibility, visibility, community. So we're working with the town on that. So you should have one soon.
Glad to hear that. Good job.
Any other questions for it's Catherine?
Yes, Mr. Chair?
Yes, go ahead, Dave.
Catherine, I have a question about satisfaction. The stuff you did at the beginning of the presentation, comparing the commercial and the residential on reliability and satisfaction. I noticed the commercial rankings were a little bit lower than the residential. And I was wondering, how is that also like that with other munis that you do the survey for? Do you see that same trend?
For sure. So I would say across the board, sorry, I'm just going through these slides quickly just so I have a reference point, but across the board, our sample size for commercial surveys tends to be a lot lower. Usually when we do commercial surveys, we get about 100 to 150 surveys. On the residential side, it's usually somewhere around 400 to 500. Obviously on this one, we got a lot more. We had 1610. So one thing to always keep in mind on these is that your sample size is a lot higher on the residential side than it was on the commercial side. And that does impact things a lot when you look at ratings like this. So when you have 88 customers, I'm not saying that's a low sample size, but it's in 1610. And so, you know, a slight, you know, a couple of disgruntled rumors make the difference in a lot of those rates on the online side or on the commercial side, I should say, versus on the residential side. Across the board, I would say, you know, obviously meme utilities tend to score a lot higher than on a national level. But even in the meme utilities, we always see the commercial ratings coming in somewhere around 5 to 6 percentage points lower. And 88.6% is still like a very high average rating on the commercial side, but it is lower than the 92% that you all scored on the residential side. But long story short, I would say those ratings, you know, the kind of difference between commercial and residential does tend to add up, and always important to keep in mind the sample size when you're looking at that data.
Thank you.
Yeah. Anyone else?
Mr. Chair, can I just interject regarding your concern about the transformers and loading? That is exactly our concern as well too. Right now, our distribution transformer loading policy is about 80%. And, you know, as these, they're being added more and more EV chargers, which each EV charger is equivalent to the load of the 3 or 4 houses. So then we're going to drop them off. But I want to add another point also, that distribution transformers are designed to take overload. That means that, you know, we can load them up to 120, 130%. What it means, it's going to cut down the life expectancy of the transformers by so many years. And then that means we're going to have to change out those transformer fasteners. But we are monitoring that. And then with purchasing the new MDM that, you know, it's in the budget for 2021, we can better monitor the loading of those transformers. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Amin. Well, Catherine, thank you very much. It's been an excellent report, and we look forward to digging into it and making some impactful changes, perhaps in our policy or funding or whatever, to try and realize the benefits of the report. But thank
excellent.
You.
I'm glad to see you all using it. Have a lovely evening, everyone. Let me just stop sharing my screen.
I'd like to move into the policy 30 discussion, and Mr. Phipps is going to be leading that as an introduction. And after he finishes, I would like to ask Vivek to provide some feedback from the CAB in terms of what they thought, how they viewed it as well, and that might modify the motion or what we're doing. So if that's acceptable, why don't we go ahead and get started. Greg.
Perfect. Good evening. Kathleen, are you driving or is Margaret? Margaret's driving. Okay, Mike, you know what? Perfect. Perfect. All right, next slide, please. Good evening. So we're going to basically kind of draw to a close the past three sessions we've been talking about the wholesale power purchase side of the business. As you guys have probably concluded, it's fairly intricate. There's a lot of considerations that we make as we build the power portfolio. I'll talk a little bit about the criteria that we use. Just a little bit of context up front. I'm not going to review all the stuff we've done in the past. I'm going to talk very briefly, a quick summary of what Roadmap 2050 looks like. This is new legislation that we anticipate is going to pass and we'll have to adhere to. We'll do just some quick comparisons, some slides that we've already looked at in the past about the cost impact for us about Roadmap 2050 versus the RPS CES, and then talk a little bit more detail about the recommendation for the revision 1 to policy 30 updates. So the current policy 30 that was done 2012 is revision 0. And so there's some fairly significant changes that we're proposing. Next slide, please. So the context, pretty quickly, one of the things just to keep in mind, as we make the various decisions, as the team makes the decision in terms of what they purchase, from a power supply perspective, they look at the RMLD mission. All of us here are here to serve our ratepayers, to serve our community. And as you saw, that excellent customer service, the competitively priced and system reliability, those are all straight out of our mission statement, which is right in the website. So it's a couple more sentences more than that, but those are the key pieces that we tend to look at. As you got from the customer survey, there's a prioritization. Reliability is first, and that's what we always try and do. And part of the reliability, as Hamid mentioned, is anticipating the growing volume. I'll give a little more context on that. But also to make sure that we minimize any rate shocks or rate impacts. We know that rates are going to continue to go up, and we'll talk a little bit more of that in some details in a few moments. You guys know that the current version of Policy 30, the sustainability energy, was really about renewable energy goals. It was not really focused on RECs. It wasn't the compliance. This was an internal policy that was put in place back in 2020. It was the power portfolio was built around this policy. The focus was not on certificates, was not on RECs, although we took them and used them to the best of our ability. And as you'll see again, we'll talk very briefly, but in the past few months, we've talked about us being ahead of the policy 30 goals that were set back in 2012, and we're already ahead of the 2025 goals. And we've done that also with a combination of certain assets that have no certificates and certain assets that do have certificates. Those that do have certificates are what we call bundled or associated certificates. So the reason why that's important is that historically what we have done is use certificates as an economic mechanism and also as a self-compliance mechanism but we haven't as loosely called used certificates for any papering to do any sort of compliance. Pending legislation, I'll get a little bit more detail into that in just a moment. We've been calling that Roadmap 2050. It also goes by S9, S13, 4993, a bunch of different numbers, but just for our discussion, think about it as being Roadmap 2050. The new name that you're gonna see coming up more and more again is MLP GGES, which is Greenhouse Gas Emission Standard. So that's gonna begin to take the name, to replace the name of Roadmap 2050, but we'll call it Roadmap 2050 for right now. That last item there from the customer survey, you know, there's an interest for our customers. Again, that's our ratepayers focus. They want us to focus on greenhouse gas emissions, but they want us to be careful in terms of the rate impacts. So we try and take that into account too in terms of the policy. Next slide, please. So this is the slide that we used on our last session. Real brief, you guys have seen this before on the, in terms of the chart itself, across the bottom, 2020 to 2030. So there's a 10-year snapshot. On the left-hand column, this is a percent of load, and the colored bars inside are basically what we have contracted and what type of contract we have. So as you look at 2020 and 2021, 2021 is a little bit different, but 2020, we keep about 15% of our portfolio open so that we can take advantage of market opportunities. And if you notice to the upper right-hand corner, open position, not yet contracted, we need to fill that load with contracts or spot. And so we'll keep some of that open for spot, but the majority of that we wanna fill with contracts. So the timing of this policy 30 is very appropriate. At 2021, we've got some load that we need to fill, and not tonight, but in the next few weeks, we're actually working on, and we have been working on a couple of projects, renewable projects, one being a hydro that we're gonna bring you guys up to speed on as well. But in terms of what the portfolio looks like right now, you get a good sense of it. This particular snapshot still includes in the green bars, that's the New England class one and class two. So that could be either Massachusetts or Connecticut or Vermont has tiers, or Maine. That green currently includes Palmer. And we'll talk a little bit more about Palmer in a few moments. But just to give you an idea what that snapshot looks like, almost all of the renewable assets below that gold line, we have certificates for. And I'll talk about that in a little bit more detail. Notice on the hydro right now, we have no RECs on the hydro, and on the solar, we have no RECs because we bought those long-term contracts without a focus in terms of buying certificates. There'll be some opportunities for us to add or to collect or to secure some of the associated RECs with those assets, particularly the hydro, which happened to be a good portion of it is NYPA. At the end of the day, in terms of achieving our 2012 version, our current version of policy 30, we've actually exceeded it. That gold line that goes across there is what the Roadmap 2050 target would look like. And when you put certificates against it, we're really just pretty much right on the line. One of the things that we talked about before is while the Roadmap 2050 has a step function, it is 20% in 2020, and then it jumps up to 50% in 2030. The way that we have been historically and the way that we're working to continue to manage our portfolio is to think about it as incremental steps so that we don't incur any rate shocks on our customer. So that's one of our goals that is inherent in how we manage the business on an ongoing basis. The other thing that we've done historically and will continue to do to the best of our ability is to purchase associated RECs. And that really drives the idea of investment in new renewable assets. So we're gonna do our best to buy either refurbished or new renewable assets where there's an associated REC. The other quick piece, before I move on to the next slide, trying to capture a lot in fairly quickly. The other key piece here is we also try and manage risk in terms of the portfolio. So different types of assets. Next slide. So this is a summary of the new legislation that's coming down the road. And a couple of key points. I'm gonna walk through the right-hand column fairly quickly, but on the left-hand side there, we say RMLD must comply. So while this legislation is not in place today, it is imminent. I mean, again, things can change in the government, but the past 3 months, the MLP portion of it has remained very stable. And it's looking like it's now called S13, it will most likely pass. So we're working under the assumption that we're going to need to meet this roadmap 2050. It's now called MLP GGES, as I mentioned before, but we're assuming that we're gonna need to meet it. And we're proposing that policy 30 recognize that fact. It is the first time in RMLD history that we've had to hit a compliance on the purchase side. That policy or that program as it's written right now on the legislation, it drives everybody, whether it's transportation, building, as we talked about before, the IOUs or the MLPs, we're all being driven toward a net zero non-carbon goal by 2050, which is no small task. As we've gotten deeper and deeper into how we're gonna make that happen, we'll talk more about that in just a few moments. But the legislation does accommodate the different business models between the IOUs and the MLPs. I do want to talk about electrification. I'll wait for the next slide on that, but that's going to be an important piece. And as Hamid mentioned, we need to be designing our rate structure, but also our infrastructure to handle a growing load. For the past 10 years, that load has been fairly flat, and that's about to change with all the electrification efforts that we're driving and that we're going to be mandated to do. So real quick, we've got five major components of this legislation: goals, sources, make, buy, certificates, and reporting. The goals are pretty straightforward: 2030, 2040, 2050. You can see the numbers. 50 non-carbon emitting energy sales. Key things to notice from that: it's non-carbon. So it's different than renewable, it's different than RECs. It's a different metric that we're shooting toward. And the policy 30 update that we're recommending reflects that. The non-carbon emitting, the definitions, this is again straight from the legislation on the sources. Non-carbon emitting, you've got the 11 elements there. Solar, both PV and thermal, you can read them all: hydro, nuclear, hydrokinetic, geothermal, landfill, anaerobic, wind energy. Number 10 is biomass, which is relevant for our discussion after we finish this session or when we get to the end of the session. And then 11 are some special cases that are made provisions for. So that's going to be important in terms of how we think about the different types of power sources that we buy from. So we're going to follow the legislation. In terms of the make-buy, the reason why that make-buy is important from our perspective, you notice from the survey that many of our customers have no plans to put solar or generation on site yet. And so we have the ability as an MLP to produce, or either to purchase or to generate within our service territory non-carbon emitting energy. And so one of the things that we'll be balancing going forward is this make versus buy and our ability to do make, production within our service territory. We're trying to make sure we keep the flexibility to do that, particularly in the context that our customers are not quite ready to do that yet. The certificates piece, the key point on this one, these are basically certificates. We're measured on retail energy sales, not what we buy, but what we sell. And so at the end of the day, you know that for the most part, we're purchasing energy and then reselling it, except for the small cases where we have solar generated on rooftops, et cetera. It's still a small piece of it. But the key thing on this certificates piece, in order to meet the compliance goals, they must be retired. So the flexibility that we had in the past of using certificates or the value of certificates to balance rate shocks, that will be coming less, we'll have less and less ability to do that just to be compliant. So we'll talk a little bit later, we had a discussion in the cab about the concept of retirement, but we are going to, in order to comply, we will be retiring more RECs going forward. The last piece there is that reporting on the ACP. And the reason why that's important is that there are reporting requirements. There are administrative requirements for us on a regular basis, both to MassDOER, specifically it's mandated. If we are not compliant for some reason, our intention is to be fully compliant, but if we're not compliant, there is a penalty. And that penalty is basically on whatever does not meet, whatever is below the threshold. Those funds, it's basically called an alternative compliance payment, but it's basically a penalty. Those funds need to be collected from RMLD if we're not compliant. And they go into a fund that basically is to fund greenhouse gas reduction programs within our service territory. The point being here is there's a penalty tied to us not being compliant. All right. So again, there's different constraints that are being put on the flexibility for us to buy power that's built into this legislation. I just put that in context. Next slide.
Mr. Chairman, before we move off the slide, can I ask a question now?
Sure.
Go ahead.
Can we go back one slide? Went the wrong way.
Okay, just page up.
So the question I have is, my understanding is Senator Barrett proposed a moratorium on biomass in terms of putting it in this category. Is that no longer the case?
So the
terms of what that is now, Senator Barrett is also a former Reading rep, state rep.
Yeah. So Phil, you're right. In that biomass, I think it's a detail that's important, but basically there's a moratorium for 5 years until 2026 in the current draft of the legislation. And that's in another part of legislation. But at the end of the day, I think we're going to end up talking in a few minutes that we'll talk about what we do with biomass. But you're right, there's a five-year moratorium that's in the draft legislation, and we'll see if that sticks or not. You're correct.
All right, thank you.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. On that point, isn't it also true that we don't have to meet anything till 2030? That was my understanding. So it doesn't really affect compliance.
Commissioner Talbot, you're right. Right, the legislation, and we'll talk. Well, we talked about this just a few moments ago. From a compliance perspective, and there'll be some modifications that we'll get into based on the feedback from the CAB. Our goal is to make those incremental increases on a more consistent basis, such as an annual basis. Because when we need to do more compliance at the end of the day, that means that we have to basically acquire, and more importantly, retire more certificates. And those, at the end of the day, whatever we do from a cost perspective, whatever compliance we hit, basically goes back to our rates and goes back to the ratepayers.
Yeah, I get that part.
Greg, would you please finish your presentation?
Yep.
Let's finish, and then we can ask questions afterwards.
Let's continue on. Next slide. So just real quick, these two slides, just to give you an order of magnitude. Remember that we had structured the portfolio, the team has structured the portfolio over the past 10 years almost around the policy 30, which is really focused on sustainable and renewable. And in order to meet, and the other thing to keep in mind that back in 2018, this roadmap 2050, RMLD was one of the several MLPs, Colleen leading the charge, to have some sort of legislation put in place so the MLPs weren't kind of off on their own. And so this roadmap 2050 is not a surprise to us. We're familiar with it. We understand what's coming down the road. The important piece is that the current snapshot or the current structure of our portfolio allows us to meet roadmap 2050 in each one of these years, 2021, 2, 3, and 4, with a minimal additional retirement of RECs that we have on hand, that we have in our portfolio. The bottom line at the end of the day is that the incremental cost to meet on an annual basis, right? If we were to basically take that gold line from the previous slide, the roadmap 2050 slide, and do an annual increment, it's going to cost us basically an incremental cost of about $300,000 to $400,000 over the next 4 years. And it will continue on, but just to give you an idea of a snapshot. In our budget, that's worth less than 1%. It's 3 to 4/10 of a percent. And remember that incremental cost flows directly to the ratepayers. All right. So in order to meet the roadmap 2050 compliance, there's a little less than 0.5% increase that we're going to face no matter what. I put that other line that's in the bottom there is our projected rate increase with the current budget. 2021 and 22 are real numbers. And I'd say real numbers, they're more solid numbers. 2023 and 24, they're probably going to change because that budget's a little bit further out. But this 0.5% is on top of the 2.5 and on top of the 3.5 that's already in the budget. So this would be incremental. Next slide. Now, if we were to incrementally make the compliance more stringent, and if we were to do an RPS CES, such as the IOUs do, and that's not what Robot 2050 says, but if we were, we had not designed our portfolio to meet that one because it wasn't a requirement. And in order to meet it, that compliance to it would require us to both buy and retire. We basically do some swapping out of certificates that we have. At the end of the day, we're going to increase the cost because what we need to do is to make the majority of our portfolio mass class one RECs that we would subsequently retire. We don't have, from that previous three slides, that colored stacked bar chart, we don't have a deep portfolio of mass class one RECs. So what this basically went through is said, given what we need and what additional ones we would be required to retire in order to meet an RPS-CES standard, it would cost us roughly $6.3 million a year, each year, just for the next 4 years, just as an order of magnitude to give you an idea of what we're looking at. If you look at our total operating budget, that basically is roughly about a 6.8% increase for just the rec management side of it. It doesn't include any of the, so in that projected rate increase across the bottom, that 2.5 and the 3.5, it would be in addition to that. And the other thing that we'll have discussions on not too far down the road is our electric, the programs that we have, the energy efficiency programs, the heat pump that, again, we're doing that thing on Tuesday, our EV charger. We have a lot of programs in place right now that are growing very quickly that are going to require us to basically move our ECC rate up as well. So we have a couple elements before we get to this compliance piece that are going to be pretty significant in terms of our rate increases. And then this would be incremental on top of it. Next slide. So what you saw in the documents that were sent to you ahead of time in the policy one, and we're calling it now policy one, not policy one, policy 30 revision one, there were A through E. So there were those five key elements. And what we're basically saying here, and I won't read through all the text just to keep things brief. You guys had a chance to look at it before. But the first thing is we're going to have to apply it to the law, right? There's a compliance. It hasn't been passed yet, but we're assuming that it's coming down the road and we're going to need to adhere to it. So pretty basically, our policy 30 are going to need to recognize that we have a legal requirement. The second piece, kind of going back to the discussion that came out of the customer survey, is there some customers that are willing to pay an incremental amount more for a renewable program. So one of the things that we're recommending is we're going to add another program. We're going to call it a renewable choice program. We're going to make it available to all customers. And you know, we're going to let the customers basically decide which program they want to be in. Now, over time, more and more of them are going to be forced into a renewable choice program because of the compliance requirement. But for the next several years, the concept here is basically to put a program together for those that want to be part of a renewable, you know, non-carbon, they have that option too. That would be in addition to the green and the solar one we already have in place. The item C basically just talks about us, you know, the charge that we have about meeting our mission statement. We have both the customer priorities and preferences. We also have franchise obligations in terms of meeting applicable laws that we're going to continue to do. We still will have the option, and we talked about this before, but we have the options, the proposal says we have the options to sell RECs that are in excess of compliance. So one of the discussions that we had before is there was some confusion about us, in order to meet compliance, we're going to have to retire those RECs. And that's a given, assuming that the legislation takes place. This item C is anything incremental above that. That's what that's all about. The last two pieces are really talking about the future, again, following the law. And then E, there was some discussion on E in terms of you know, obviously we are going to set this up so that this policy will be reviewed on a more frequent basis than we have done recently. The discussion that we had, well, I'll let Vivek kind of bring what the CAB talked about. I'm going to end there before I go to slide nine, which is, well, the last thing I want to say before we jump to slide nine, and then Mr. Chairman, you can have Vivek bring the feedback from the CAB. But what we tried to do is structure the new policy to be the main policy. And then we had an attachment, which is basically had a little more details behind it. And the idea behind the attachment is those would reflect the legislative changes that we assume, well, we're pretty certain are gonna be coming down. What is approved this spring will probably get refined and modified over the next several years. And so we're trying to set up a structure that allows us to accommodate that without having to do major revisions to policy 30. So that's how we structured it. And that's why you're gonna see, the next slide that talks about two different motions in terms of approving. That's all for me.
Thank you, Greg. Vivek, could you please comment on what the CAB is recommending?
So John, yeah, thank you, appreciate it. If it's okay with you, I'd just like to share it because it'll be efficient if I share my screen because I've tried to capture it so that everyone can read that stuff.
Sure.
Yeah. So can everyone see this? So there were I just want to summarize that, you know, the two motions, Reading voted against the Rev 1, which included biomass, and motion 2, which had no biomass, passed 4.0. And Greg talked about, in the elements slide, he talked about element C. So there was a recommendation, and which was accepted by the CAB, that RMLD will retire only those certificates which go beyond those required for compliance with the MLP regulations. Okay, so that was regarding the compliance issue. There was a specific recommendation that was made by the CAB, which passed 4.0, which was to review the policy 30 on a regular basis. Because right now it says that the Board of Commissioners will review it as needed. Or from time to time. And what we're saying is that there's going to be a lot of changes along the way. So it's good to have some schedule to say 3 years or sooner. So that way we're not waiting for like 9 years of reviewing something since 2012. And so this is the language I try to capture, that RMLD recommends that the Board of Commissioners review the policy every 3 years or sooner. And if you read the policy 30 language now, it says RMLD will regularly review the environment and plan to report to the Board of Commissioners on a monthly basis. So that's fine, but we wanted to put the first line and the CAB recommended it 4.0. So we hope you will respect that. And we are saying that if RMLD identifies potential changes, then such changes will be reviewed and adopted if required.
Thank you, Vivek. Does anyone on any of the commissioners have any issue with adding the line item to our motion that Vivek has suggested, the CAB has suggested? Yes, Mr. Pacino. You're on mute. Mute. We unmute Mr. Phil, please.
I got it. All right. I muted myself. All this technology, you know? So I listened in to the CAB meeting. I think that we could probably add this under item B1. At the end of B1, we could put in responsible for approving this policy and then add after that, every 3 years by December 31st of the third year. And that gives, my concern is, you know, we're not gonna all be here for the next 30 years like I am, you know? And so, you know, we need to future boards. I mean, Dave's disappearing next month.
Right.
You know, there needs to be some sort of sunset provision or some sort of requirement that the board hit this every 3 years. And that's why I'm suggesting, you know, I know Vivek wrote something further under, down below under 5E, and I tried to fit it in there and I just couldn't do it. You know, but I think if we put something under 4B1, just at the end of that, approving this policy every 3 years by December 31st of the third year. December 31st is our year end in each case now. So that's what I'm suggesting that we do. And I'm willing to make a motion if acceptable.
I certainly have no issue with that. Other commissioners' comments, if any?
I have no issue with that. That makes sense.
Why don't you go ahead and make a motion then?
Okay, then I will move to amend policy 30, revision one.
About adding the comments in, you know, about the rec. I'm just not so sure that that's necessary. That could be restricting in the future to us about, you know, retiring it, you know, at a certain point beyond, you know, reaching a certain point and beyond. I guess I'm struggling with that language because I could see that being restrictive in the future.
Bob, I don't think we're adding the rec.
You're right, we're not adding the rec.
Just adding the, we must review it every 3 years.
Right.
That's all.
No, but.
So the motion I'm making is under B1, where it says responsible for approving this policy, adding at the end, every 3 years by December 31st of the third year. And that you know, makes the future boards a requirement on the future board so they don't forget. And
thank you, Phil. That was the spirit of bringing this up.
Mr. Chair, can I make a...
Go ahead.
So we don't really have any hardwired review in any of the policies. I know Vivek had mentioned earlier policy 18, but that's a three-year review of the RMLD staff to review the strategic plan, not for the board to review the policy. So what we were doing is at the top of the policy, as part of the heading, it says review date, the next review date. So just letting you know the way we've done it with all the other policies, if you wanna start changing that, I just want to make a point that we don't have any like that right now, so.
Yeah, I appreciate that. I think that, I don't think it hurts anything to put in a hard stop to say, right, if you haven't looked at it in 3 years, look at it. And so I have no issue with doing that for future boards. I mean, if the future boards decide they don't want to do that, I suppose they could vote it out. But
exactly.
Or as I'm concerned, I'm hoping that the other commissioners are on board that having a very specific three-year review basically just challenges the board to make sure that they have it on their radar.
Especially, but this is such an important policy going forward now.
Yes, Colleen.
We are going to be any legislation that comes through will be brought to the board because we're doing an update every month. That's what we're committing to in the policy. Right. So every single month, we're going to talk about any legislative changes that would go on attachment two. So it's going to be every month. So that's going to be happening whether you add the language or not. So
we're
good. Whatever is the pleasure of the board.
I think if the CAB has recommended that we add it, I think we should add it. I don't think it hurts anything.
That's what I think. I mean, what's the downside? I can't think of anything.
Right.
Needs a second.
Okay, second. Any further discussion? Can I have a roll call vote, please? Mr. Stempak?
This is on the amendment?
On the amendment, yes.
Thank you, Vivek.
May I ask who seconded that? I'm sorry.
Dave Hennessy seconded.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Heard him. Did you vote on this?
Me?
Yeah.
The amendment's fine, yes.
Mr. Hennessy, aye. Yeah.
Okay, good. So,
Mr. Coulter, aye. One more.
Okay, good. Can we move on, Greg, to the, is it the next one, the motion?
Yep, absolutely. Kathleen, if you put that slide 9 up, there's two steps of the process.
Can I make a comment, please?
Yes.
In the CAB meeting, we had public comment from Mr. Rogers indicating that he wanted more language or was suggesting more language to, as Greg had shown you, how we were going to be retiring recs and how we're going to be looking at this. It's done incrementally over the time. We're not going to do something and then wait 10 years and then do something because that could create a rate shock. So naturally the way we run the business would be this way. Now, we don't want this to be a requirement. We want it to be a goal because it aligns with how we would be purchasing and retiring the recs. So the revised motion that I would be recommending in order to incorporate that would be as follows. Move that the Board of Commissioners vote to direct the General Manager to revise Policy 30 to include incremental compliance with applicable law, where possible, to mitigate potential rate shocks and to approve Policy 30 under the recommendation of the General Manager with such changes. So that captures that we'll be not going every 10 years, but also gives us a little bit of wiggle room because we have to make sure these plants are being built, that we can get the recs, and you're going to be getting updates every single month. So again, it's not a strict requirement. The law could change to go to annual increments. So we have to follow the law as a minimum.
Colleen, where is that in the in the revision number one document that you wanted?
It was brought up in the CAB. So we have in the past, we revised the motion to include that, and then we'll just add it in the policy. But you're voting on a review, approval of the policy, providing the general manager add that language in there, just as I stated, incremental, to include incremental compliance with applicable law where possible to mitigate potential rate shock. And we would add that in, I have it right in front of me, right in the...
Mr. Chair, can we have this up on the screen somehow, what we're being suggested? So that we fully understand, I fully understand it.
I agree, yes. You know, can we put the revision number one, is that correct, up on the screen?
Can you just put policy 30 up, please?
Yes, policy 30, sorry.
Okay.
And what we're asking is, where were you, are you suggesting we add that in this document so that we're all clear? But I don't think it's a bad statement. I think it's fine what you're trying to accomplish. I'm just not sure where it fits, that's all. Yeah. And if we're going to vote on this tonight, well, I would like to make sure that we have the right language.
Mm-hmm. I think somebody should give their puppy a little puppy treat or something.
Oh, can you hear that? I'm sorry.
Is it a bird?
She has a muzzle on, so she doesn't bark. Can you go up? Kathleen, the next page.
Go up or down?
Or down, sorry.
That's all right, sorry.
So it would go in a policy element. So you can put it in policy element A.
Okay.
And it would just say to include incremental compliance with applicable law. Shall comply with all applicable law and include incremental compliance with applicable law. It will be the sentence. I can.
Mr. Chair, is there a Word document we can pull up here and make the change to that?
Kathleen, can you make a revision to it right now?
Right. So
I can try.
Mr. Chair, can I ask a question while that's being done?
Yes, please do.
I wanted to ask Vivek from the CAB. On this motion, there was one no. Is that right, Vivek?
Yes.
And could you just summarize what it was, what the reason why the no, if you're willing to?
Yes, I was the no. And for Reading, I was representing Reading, and the no was for biomass inclusion in that policy. Rev 2 is without biomass.
Okay.
We'll be eliminating biomass in the second motion.
Mm-hmm. Okay, got it. All right.
Kathleen, do you have that up?
I don't yet. I'm trying to locate it. I'm sorry. I apologize. I'm not even sure I have the Word document. I may just have the PDF, but I'm trying to locate that now. Actually, I can probably edit it on the PDF.
Yeah.
So.
John, could I ask a question? Well, again, while we're waiting. So Mr. Rogers made a statement, you know, looking to, and he made a statement about RECs and certificates and purchasing. And it seemed to go a little bit against what Greg was saying, if I understood him right, because Greg was saying we could separate the two and sell them. And Mr. Rogers, I don't want to speak to Mr. Rogers, but if I misunderstood, I hope I might've misunderstood him. He said, you could not do that, or you should not do that. And Greg, I don't know if you could maybe explain that a little bit more, when he was making that statement in the cab. I wasn't.
Yeah. I think he had two key points. One was the concept of incremental increase. again, the same concept we talked about with that gold line on the stacked bar chart to minimize rate yep. shock. So he was just, he was trying to emphasize that point. And then the second point would be that in order to, for him, basically, from his perspective, in order to comply with whatever whatever legislation, in this particular case, the MLP, GGES, those RECs for compliance have to be retired and cannot be sold. And that wasn't explicit in the draft of the policy 30, because it was implied in order to meet the compliance, the regulatory requirement would force us to retire, not sell. He just wanted to make sure that everybody understood that retirement is the only way to comply, and we're in agreement. Does that make sense? Those are the 2 points.
Okay. Yeah. So when it was the selling point and retiring point that I wasn't quite keeping up with them.
Right.
So it is a very fine point. So thank you.
It's good. And I going forward, we're going to be required to retire those to meet the compliance. And we've been historically been doing a certain level, but now it's going to be a regulatory or legislative compliance. And we're understand that and in agreement.
Good. So could we, Kathy, able to add anything?
Yeah. I'm able to share now, so I'll share and I can, and you can let me know, Colleen, exactly. The RMLD shall comply with.
This would be on section 4A.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and it should say, the RMLD shall strive to incrementally comply.
I don't think that goes there. I think it's a new second sentence.
Oh, okay, sorry, take that out.
So this sentence would follow the first sentence.
Yeah.
After attachment,
right? After here. Obligations.
Okay.
Yeah. The RMLD shall strive to incrementally comply. On a regular basis.
Comply
on a regular basis with applicable law. Where possible, to mitigate potential rate shock. You got it.
Okay, good. Any comments from the commissioners on the ad?
I just don't quite understand. What's the purpose of that addition?
It's just capturing the way we would be doing the business, which means we're not going to start and then not do anything for 10 years. It's incremental over time. Is the way we're going to be doing it, and it's just capturing that.
So
if you have a compliance in 2030 and then 2040, we're not going to have a compliance in 2030 and then do nothing till 2050 and then shock everybody. We're doing it linearly in accordance with the line that Greg showed you. So what Mr. Rogers was saying was, you don't really capture that in the policy. So I've been working on the language since the last meeting to put this in, so it reflects exactly how we will be doing it.
Sure. So, and I mean, and I think this is good, because no matter what general manager anytime in the future, this basically binds them to basically do that on an incremental basis instead of basically just going for step functions. So
correct.
I think it makes a lot of sense to actually be explicit. The more explicit we can be, I think, is good. In terms of meeting our requirements.
So,
and again, there'll be monthly updates to show you exactly every month where we are.
If the goal is to have us be meeting annual targets between now and 2030 and then between 2030 and 2040, that's a great goal, but this language has a number, it has a bunch of caveats. It just says that the department shall strive, and then comma where possible, and then with applicable law. So we know the law doesn't actually require anything between now and 2030. So there's so many trap doors in this sentence that it doesn't really leave.
The reason I thought, Mr. Chair, may I?
Yeah, go ahead, Chris, go ahead.
Dave, or Commissioner Talbot, one of the reasons that I had suggested to Colleen that we have some of those carve outs is because we don't know what the law would do. So we're definitely going to comply with applicable law. And the goal would be to incrementally add these, which if we don't have an obligation till 2030, we can incrementally do that. But if the legislation were to change and all of a sudden in 2022, you know, we have to increase our purchase amount by 50%, there's not an opportunity to incrementally comply. We're just going to have to do the step. So that was the reason for the...
I recall when we had a different version of policy 30, I had suggested an edit that was explicit that said, you know, we'll, whatever the numbers are, 22% in 2023, 25% in 2024, like actually putting numbers in the policy on an annual or every other year. I forget what I wrote. So that would be a type of edit that I would say would really bind us and future folks.
I don't, Mr. Talbot, I don't think that is appropriate. Since okay. We don't know what the future is going to be, we don't know what the laws are, and to bind ourselves into think something in the future, which we didn't know the COVID was going to be here a year ago. So right. I not suggest we put in explicit numbers, but bear with the best of intention for our customers, which we've been doing for 100 years and trying to do the best for them. So I think the intent of this is to say we're responsive to our customers on every possible level that we can possibly be. And that's how I read this.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Phil.
Should we put the word annual in front of basis, or is that going to be a problem? Always on a regular annual basis.
I have no issue with that. Colleen, would you or anyone else have an issue with a...
No, Chris or Colleen has a problem Chris? With
that. No, I don't have a problem with that. I think... Like I said, we got to get in. This is the first time we're going to have law implemented on us. We don't know what renewable plants are going to be built. We don't know if there's going to be RECs to buy. That's why I'm saying, that's why we're committing to a monthly update. We are going to be doing it incrementally because that's what makes the most business sense. But I agree, Phil, you can put annual in there.
That's
fine too. But I don't look at this as trap doors. I look at this as, if you're running power supply division, it's going to be really difficult. And I think we should take it according to the law and look at it every month. And if it looks like we can do more and do better, that's why we have attachment 1 and 2, and you can add more and we can give feedback and say, this is going well. We can do a little bit more. It's not costing as much. And we just keep going. But I think we got like Greg said, we got a lot of costs coming in from a lot of other directions. And we just want to make sure that we can meet it. This is a goal, not a requirement. That one sentence is a goal.
Yes, Mr. Chair, I have a question too.
Go ahead.
Okay, yeah, my question is, why is the word comply in this sentence? I understand why it's in the first sentence, because that's, we have to comply with the law. But that comply word's throwing me off there, because we're not, this is more like, we want to try to stay on pace so there's no shock. It's not, we're not complying in the middle between 2020 and 2030. We're just trying to keep it on a glide path to those targets, right? It's just, the word comply is throwing me off as I'm reading it.
Right.
That's fine. I mean, the first sentence talks about that we have to stay in compliance no matter what.
Right. The first sentence. We have to comply. Yeah. The second sentence is just saying we want to smooth it out, right? It's not... Yes. I don't understand why it complies in the second. So maybe Chris Pollard would have a view on that, why it should be there. I don't know.
Mr. Chair, may I?
Yes, please go ahead.
Commissioner Hennessy, that good point. We're not going to incrementally comply with applicable law. We're going to comply with applicable law.
Right.
So maybe something along the lines of the RMLD shall strive to make incremental changes on an annual basis.
Yes.
where possible. And then delete to where possible.
Right.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's kind of like.
Need another comma.
After the word basis. Yes, perfect.
Because it's kind of, now this sentence is making more sense to me because it's like Greg's straight line. It's like, we're going to try to stay on that line. There's going to be bumps up and down, but we're going to always try to stay on it to stay on the roadmap, right?
Yes, excellent.
That's it, perfect. Yep, that's it, you got it.
Okay, if there's any more discussion, if not, I think we have to vote on this.
You got a choice. You could accept it as part of the main motion. If there's no objection, or I can make an amendment.
I'd like to accept it on the main motion.
And this is okay.
Do I need to have a vote on that, Phil?
No. Unless only if there's objection from any other member.
Okay. And if there's no objection, shall we have a roll call vote? Go ahead. We need to read the motion first, correct?
Okay. Yep. You ready?
Yes.
Move that the Board of Commissioners vote to approve Policy 30 under the recommendation of the General Manager.
Could I have a second, please?
Second.
Could I just comment before we vote?
Yes,
please. Yes, discussion? Sure, go ahead.
So I think there's, first of all, there's people who wanted to comment and it's too bad they couldn't, but my take on this is, so I appreciate the effort of the policy, you know, but we are only seeing this for the first time as a board tonight, and public comment was not allowed before we deliberated, and the state law that this policy references hasn't yet passed, so it feels premature for us to be acting on this. We also have fresh survey data showing that 2/3 of ratepayers, you know, want us to be aggressive on greenhouse gas emissions, and 60%. Or almost that many are willing to pay more. Now, I know the proposed policy has this opt-in approach called renewable choice for such people, but what we don't know is whether opt-in is really the best way to leverage all of that huge interest while also protecting those who can't pay. And there's reason to be skeptical that it is the best way to leverage. So I think we should be doing more research on what's been done elsewhere and learn more before we vote on this. Because of those unaddressed questions, I will be voting no on this.
Thank you, Mr. Talbot. I take a note of your objection. I think I do believe that that's incorrect. We've been wrestling this for a long time. I think pushing this off for another year or 2 years while we look at all possible permutations of it is the wrong thing to do. I think we put a stake in the sand with this. And the next motion, and we move forward. And then if we need to change it, we can change it in the future. But to just drift away in the ocean without anything here, I think is absolutely the wrong thing to do.
Well, it's the first time we've seen this draft. It was completely different than the one that was all last year. I'm not saying there's not good things in it. It's just, it's the very first time we've seen it. And it's the only time we've had to deliberate it, and we're being asked to vote it right now, right away, without any public comment. So I think, you know, it seems like a rush, and it's not necessary to do it this way.
Well, I would like to move forward and ask for a vote on this, please. Can we have a roll call vote for accepting the motion?
Mr. Pacino,
excuse me, John. This doesn't have the amendment at the bottom, right? This doesn't have the biomass.
That's the next one. Yeah.
Okay. Right. Just I don't want to confuse things. Thank you.
Mr. Stempak, aye.
Mr. Hennessy, aye.
Mr. Talbot, nay.
Mr. Coulter, aye.
Phil?
Yeah, aye, Mr. Chair.
Aye, okay. So let it be noted that it was 4-1 approved and passed.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Okay. Can we move on to the second motion, please?
You want to make the motion?
Yes, please.
Okay. Move that the Board of Commissioners vote to approve the exclusion of future biomass as an acceptable, renewable, or greenhouse gas reduction resource of generation under Policy 30 on the recommendation of the General Manager.
I have a second.
Second.
Discussion?
Yeah, why did we not include wood-burning biomass? I thought, I know I'm the one that started the whole biomass thing, but so the wood-burning biomass was talked about. General, just want to put in this motion. Maybe there's
I understand your comment because there are many different biomes. Perhaps deal with them as they come along. The major types of generation, I think we're all very familiar with. But Dave, I take your comment to heart. And how do the commissioners feel? Should we modify this to say just wood burning?
Well, you know, John, maybe there's concerns about other biomass. I don't know. You know, I just know that wood burning is something that I'm not for, and that many of us are up for. What about the other biomass?
John, can I please make a comment here, just for clarification? Can I just make a clarification?
You may make a comment. Thank you.
Thank you. Because Dave, when you look at different biomass, anaerobic digester biomass is number 8. So that is different from number 10, which is biomass. So if you can point to that, right? So if you look at the sources, so if you look in the policy 30 amendment 1, the sources, anaerobic digester gas is not being discussed. You're only talking about biomass, which is separate from anaerobic and landfill methane. So landfill methane and anaerobic digester gas is not included here.
Okay.
So this is
good.
So, yes, Bob.
So, you know, one comment. I know we're planning a future policy by removing the word biomass. And again, I'm a big proponent of, let's go with what the legislation says. I don't want to vary off of what the state law says. Just leave it in. It doesn't hurt, right? If we choose not to purchase the RECs, it's irrelevant. I mean, we shouldn't put it in a policy and exclude it, because then someone's going to point it out and someone's going to forget this discussion 5 years down the line. I say we leave it in. And another example is, let's look at the Midwest real quick. Energy crisis out there. Renewable resources don't work. You need sources that can burn. That can burn. I hate to say that. It's a bad word because it burns. But leave it. And because it might be a source that you might, that might be the only plant running in a blizzard in 10 years. Okay. We don't know that. You can't predict that. So those types of things, again, you mentioned COVID. I just hate boxing yourself in. If we choose as a group not to purchase biomass from Palmer, which I believe as a consensus we're working towards, great, but go with what the state policy says. It's so simple. You just follow whatever MGL, whatever it is, you know, roadmap 2050, leave it in. It's a straight approach. We're going around and around about biomass. It's 0.0000% of the usage of Massachusetts. It's such a minute portion, and we're debating it nonstop. I just don't see any benefit of removing it specifically. We don't like it. We won't purchase it. We're getting out of the deal. Let's move on. There's no reason why, you know, it could be deemed the best thing since sliced bread in 5 years. Okay. So let's just leave my 2 cents. Thank you.
Okay. Any other comments from commissioners?
Well, couldn't we I see your point, Bob. You're making a good point, because there are catastrophes that could happen. But if we ever got in a jam, you know, like where there was only one source and it had to be, couldn't we change the policy? We could just, as a future board, could just change our policy.
Right.
They won't remember it like we didn't remember it. I mean, it's just, it's just what happens. And someone will bring it up and be like, hey, you can't do that. So so that's the point, right? Let's just follow what the law says and what's available. So,
yeah.
It won't surprise anybody that I think this is a good idea. In my opinion, I think Dave's modifier on wood burning might be not a bad idea. I think we should make a statement and not just leave it to lobbyists to decide. You know, we've seen what results. We've seen, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars given to this guy because we let lobbyists do what they want, speaking for us. You know,
Dave, please.
Restore local control.
Okay. I'm sorry, but you've gone over this in numerous things already, and we don't want to get back to your 5-minute discussion about this. and your feelings about it. We've seen it, we've heard it. Thank you very much. Now, I would like to move this forward in terms of a vote, if everyone is ready. Could I ask for a roll call vote?
What's the motion so we know what we're...
Phil, would you read the motion again, please?
Okay, the motion is move that the Board of Commissioners vote to approve the exclusion of future biomass as an acceptable renewable or greenhouse gas reduction resource of generation under Policy 30 on the recommendation of the General Manager.
Yeah, we're not adding wood burning to that?
I'd leave it as just biomass. We can always go back and change this in the future.
Second.
Okay, I'd like
Couldn't we change it now, John? I mean, why can't we? I mean, the wood burning biomass is what we're concerned about. Why don't we just put it in there?
I have no issue with putting it in there. Is that something that the commissioners would like to see, wood burning biomass?
I would. You know, to Bob Coulter's point, if we can, you know, give ourselves a little bit more leeway, I'd like to do that. Just say wood burning biomass. I mean, to make a statement too, you know, because I don't think we'd want something like that built in Reading. So I think it's a good statement more than anything, and future boards can always change it.
So you'd like wood burning biomass in Massachusetts, but it's okay to purchase it in Vermont where there's nobody around.
Smells good in Vermont.
Yeah.
there's multiple ones across the Northeast. This is not the only one.
I only want it in your fireplace, John. That's the only place I want wood burning.
Right. Okay. Listen, I have no problem adding wood burning to this if everyone else, all the other commissioners agree. Wood burning biomass.
Is everybody okay with adding that language?
Bill, could you reread the motion, please, with wood burning?
I don't agree with the what's being said. Have somebody else read it, please.
Okay.
All right, I'll read it. I'm going to bring it up again. I had it on my phone. My phone went to sleep. Okay.
And I thought Texas was frozen gas lines, not problems with turbines.
It's multiple. It's a lot of things. It's all the energy sources that went offline. It's not just gas. Right. Yeah, they didn't build it cold weather standards, but they lost all sources of generation all over the place.
And plus, their grid is isolated, right, from the rest of the country. The Texas grid.
No, it's well, to some extent, they're all connected. Up and down, it should be in the 115 grid. But when you get down to the substation level, it's what can you do? One goes one offline, they get the brownout effect. So,
Dave, what you need to do is you need to make a motion to add the word wood burning before biomass.
Okay, I'd like to make a motion to add the word wood burning before the word biomass.
Right, I'll second that.
Okay, can I have a roll call vote, please?
Mr. Hennessy, aye.
Stenbeck, aye.
Talbot, aye.
Coulter, aye.
Ms. Pacino, no.
Okay. So please record 4-1.
I thought you didn't want that, Bob. I thought you didn't want to vote for that.
Oh, I mean, three to two. I watch Jeopardy. I know when I'm going to win or lose.
Well.
Okay,
and I mentioned Bob's points when I added that caveat. So
I'm sorry to ask.
Okay,
these plants are in Maine. They're in Vermont. They're in New England, and you know, whatever, they're not big enough to generate. So
I'm sorry to ask this again, but can I say who seconded that?
I did, Ms. Pacino.
Okay, thank you.
Okay,
We're now at the point for doing the next RMLD board meeting, but I would now like to.
No, you haven't voted on the main.
You're gonna vote on the big motion now, John.
I'm sorry. Please have a reading.
Okay.
All right. I'll move that the Board of Commissioners vote to approve the exclusion of future wood burning biomass as an acceptable renewable or greenhouse gas reduction resource of generation under Policy 30 and the recommendation of General Manager.
Second. Mr. Hennessy, second.
Thank you.
Could I have a roll call vote, please?
Mr. Hennessy, aye.
Mr. Stenbeck, aye.
Sorry, what's this vote for? I got distracted.
to remove wood burning biomass from our policy.
Yeah.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. 5-0. Please record that. We're now at the point in the meeting. I said we would open this up to public comment. If there is anyone who would like to make a public comment, limited to 2 minutes before we move into executive session. I don't see any hands or anyone there, so I'm going to move forward here in determining the next RMLD meeting, tentative date, March 18th, Thursday, at our usual 7:30, I assume. Is that reasonable for everyone?
Fine. Does it have to be a Thursday?
Well, no, it doesn't have to be. I mean, it's a major storm, we move it anyway, but.
Right, that's right. Does anybody have a problem if it's the Wednesday, the 17th, or the?
That's St. Patrick's Day, isn't it?
Hey, that's
it can't be St. Patrick's Day. Could it be the following week, or do we need to have it that week?
I don't know that we have, Colleen, I'm going to have to ask you, do we have things that are pending that need to be done that week, or should we move it, or could we move it flexibly next week?
We do have a number of policies that require review that are in the queue, and I like to give the board, you know, a week or so to be able to review that and provide comments back to me. So we have a lot of work queued up, and we are having the heat pump webinar too that many of you might want to attend, and that's March 2nd. So.
Okay, I'll move my other board meeting. I hear you. Let's go with the 18th.
Thank you, Dave.
Best for everybody.
My last meeting,
Mr. Chair.
Oh, that's right. Well, we'll have to have a cake or something. You know, maybe. Yeah. The CAB meeting coverage next month is myself. Okay, good. So, if there's no objections, I'd like to. Move into executive session.
Okay.
Mr. Pacino, please.
Yeah, move that the Board of Commissioners go into executive session pursuant to Mass General Laws, Chapter 164, Section 47D, exemption from public records and open meeting requirements in certain instances to discuss competitively sensitive issues regarding options for power supply and return to regular session for the sole purpose of adjournment.
Have a second?
Second.
Okay, could I have a roll call vote then, please? Mr. Stempak, aye. Mr.
Pacino, aye.
Talbot, aye.
Mr. Hennessy, aye.
Mr. Coulter, aye.
Thank you very much. Let's move into executive adjournment. Move into the executive session at this point. Thank you.
Thank you.